Victoria has recorded its deadliest day of the coronavirus pandemic. The grim milestone of 10 deaths included a man in his 40s, the country's youngest victim. And more heartbreak awaits with 459 new infections. Army officers will continue to bolster the front line, training with paramedics from tomorrow. But people continue to flout the rules, 126 fines handed out. There are growing fears for Victorians' mental health, with the six-week lockdown likely to be extended. Mark Santomartino begins our coverage.
As anti-maskers argued with police.
Have I committed a crime?
Yes.
It's a criminal matter now for not wearing a mask?
Yes, correct.
Victoria was recording its deadliest day yet.
This is not about human rights. Well, there's 10 families that are going to be burying someone in the next few days. Wear a mask.
A man in his 40s, the state's youngest coronavirus victim so far, is among those 10 new deaths. Seven men aged between 40 and 90, and three women in their 70s and 80s. Victoria's death toll now stands at 71. Seven of today's fatalities are linked to aged care clusters, but the Premier's focus last night, at least on Facebook, was young Victorians.
I'm not their father. I'm not their boss. I'm not their teacher. I'm just putting a really clear message to them.
18 to 29-year-olds account for between 30 and 40% of new infections. Today, another 459 tests came back positive. 22 cases were reclassified, taking the state's total to 8,181. More than 4,000 infections are still active, including 381 healthcare workers. Tomorrow, 20 ADF soldiers will start training to cover for sick paramedics.
They won't be involved in direct patient care. They'll obviously be supporting our paramedics in providing that care, but particularly around carrying equipment, driving back while the paramedics are delivering care, moving stretchers, those type of things.
Another 200 paramedic students are now helping the Department of Health's contact tracing. It took Joe Sofra 1 week to get his positive result. He says none of his close contacts have been called.
It's just a joke. Mentally, it's draining. I haven't contacted anyone. I've actually done my own tracing.
Premier, whatever resources are needed to speed up testing, to speed up the results and to speed up contact tracing, you'll have my support and the opposition's support for it. We need to get this done. This is not the time to be penny pinching.
In the wake of Cedar Meats, abattoir outbreaks continue to climb. 90 cases have now been linked to Somerville Retail Services at Tottenham, 69 to JBS in Brooklyn and 60 to Thomastown's Batoki Small Goods. Outside the lockdown near Geelong, Colac's Australian Lamb Company cluster has surged to 47 cases.
That is, by its very nature, an outbreak, a known and contained outbreak, as best you can ever contain one of these things.
As testing hit a record near 43,000 swabs in a day, the government has started pushing a new ad campaign.
We are incredibly proud of the work she does, but we're also really scared.
We've got to look after our medical staff, because if they get sick, we're in big trouble.
Masks and face coverings have been adopted swiftly, but there's no guarantee lockdown 2.0 will end after 6 weeks.
I can't tell you where we're going to be in another 3.5 weeks. These things change rapidly, but you'd have to say that these numbers are far too high.
Scary as it is that Victoria and, in fact, Australia has lost its youngest victim to the coronavirus yet, some of those fighting for life in hospital tonight, Alicia, are even younger still. Four patients spread across our hospitals in Victoria are under the age of 40. Two of them are between the ages of 20 and 29. Now, our hospital system can easily cope with 42 patients that need intensive care. However, the majority of them are over the age of 60. Still, these younger patients are a stark reminder that this virus does not discriminate and that everyone is susceptible. Alicia?
Absolutely. Okay, Mark Santomartino, thank you. St Basil's Aged Care in Fawkner tonight stands accused of serious mismanagement as cases linked to that facility soar. Nicholas Barbousis says his father caught the virus at the home, and on the same day he was admitted to the ICU, St Basil's told him his dad was healthy and in his room. Reid Butler has this exclusive report.
This FaceTime call would be the last time Nicholas Barbousis would see his dad, Paul.
Love you.
Love you.
You'll be fine.
It's just awful.
Paul had been a resident at the COVID-stricken St Basil's aged care home in Fawkner. Staff assured the 79-year-old's family he would be safe from the virus.
We were told that It was isolated in the dementia unit, which is basically the high care area.
Paul was admitted to the Northern Hospital on Friday after a fall, but it was his high fever and irregular heartbeat that concerned doctors.
Their feeling at the time was that it was COVID because he was coming from the institution that was infested by the disease.
Paul tested positive and was moved to the intensive care unit.
We miss you and we love you.
Later that day, Nick received a call from the facility's newly appointed communications team based in South Australia. He was told his father was feeling well and resting in his room.
Told her that my dad was actually in hospital, and what she was telling me was the news was completely inaccurate and it was old. And things had changed significantly, and my dad was fighting for his life.
The call turned Nick's grief into anger, but the family tried to put the pain aside today as they celebrated eldest daughter Elena's 13th birthday.
I guess there is the possibility that he will die on my daughter's birthday. So, it's all hard to take.
Paul died this afternoon. 78 COVID cases and at least 5 other deaths have been linked to the facility. It's been plagued by reports of poor infection control, and today discarded PPE was scattered in the car park. St Basil's is ignoring requests for comment, but its chairman, Constantin Kontis, did send a letter to residents' families. In it, he says in 50 years he's never been able to get a fair go from the press, adding the media does nothing but sensationalise news to attract viewers.
Please understand that you're not invincible. This could happen to you.
And Reid is at Estia Aged Care in Ardea tonight. Reid, cases are skyrocketing across the sector, and today the Premier said facilities will be held accountable.
That's right, Alicia. 82 cases have now been linked to Estia Aged Care here in Ardea. That's more than any other aged care facility in Australia. The sector is actually regulated by the federal government, and the federal government has taken over St Basil's to try and stem the surge of deaths there. But stories of mismanagement and chaos, they just keep on coming. And today, the Premier was grilled on the issue.
Individual providers of aged care, obviously they have to be accountable for what they have or haven't done. I'll make no comment on that individual nursing home, but any time there is a death, then there's the potential of the coroner looking at that. And of course, that would be entirely a matter for them.
The fact that only yesterday was the call made for compulsory PPE is just simply extraordinary. We need to learn the lessons of other aged care facilities in other states where there have been problems.
Alicia, another grim figure here. Tonight, more than 530 Victorians linked to aged care facilities are currently battling COVID-19.
Just heartbreaking. OK, Reid, thank you.